70s burnout. Now, that was rude. I'm here today talking to you. I can't hear myself. There I am. I'm here today talking to you about Friday night and what it means to me. It doesn't mean a damn thing. Now, I don't know what to do. Steve Rush won't call in because he says he's on his way out the door. Steve, what am I going to do with you? You have gone off and left me. You have promised me you're going to call in. You never call in. And so, what am I left with to think? You don't want to be on my show anymore. I've even promised I won't pick up anybody else's calls. I will not pick up, not even Mr. Midnight Movies. Just me and you. But you've always got something else to do. Wham, wham, wham. So here I sit with nothing to do on a Friday night. I'm all alone. Bored out of my freaking mind. Now, what I was referring to is Joe Seeker did a show earlier today. It was really funny. And it was called Dumped by Debbie. And let me show you what he said. It was kind of funny. Sorta.
I went over to the Debbie Daly show last night because, as you know, me and Debbie have been a big item lately. You know what I mean? I'm expecting her to, be all like she's been with me, and geez, I get over there and it's nothing like that at all. It's like I don't even exist when she's around, like all of her big shot Spreaker friends. You know what I mean? I went from being a hero to a zero. Yeah, me. You know what I mean? Snubbed. In her chat. What did I ever do to her? You know what I mean? What did I ever do to her?
Okay, now we all realize that Joe's playing. He's just trolling. He's having some fun. But I got to show you how this idiot on here takes it seriously, okay? She goes, "What happened, poor baby?" And of course, we all know who it is, that fat ass up in Oklahoma. "I am in rare form. I feel so good. Baby, baby. Mr. Midnight Movie was on Skype earlier. Debbie doesn't know that we still talk. Sweetie, poor baby. I was worried about you. I will bitch slap her. I have good news for you. Let me cheer you up. Don't drink the dumpster juice. Are you okay, Joe? I told him to be careful. That bitch. The dumpster has a trial this month. She's probably projecting her fear and her anger onto him. Debbie may be going to federal jail. I predict that she won't be on Spreaker much." And I'm thinking, oh my God. Get over yourself. What the federal trial? What the fuck are you even talking about?
Just hurts. Do you know what hurt? The only thing I could think of last night or yesterday that hurt more than being snubbed by Debbie Daly in her chat was listening to Mr. Midnight Movie talk like he understood things.
Hey, that wasn't very nice. That wasn't very nice. That was uncalled for. So here comes another. Oh, let's see. Oh, I know what I'll play for him. This will be another one for Joe. Whoops. There we go.
"When I first saw you, I saw love. And the first time you touched me, I felt love. And after all this time, you're still the one I love."
Yeah, looks like we made it. Look how far. Come on, baby, we might have took the long way. We knew we'd get there someday. They said, I bet they'll never make it. But just look at us holding on. We're still together, still going strong.
Still the one I listen to. You're still the one I think that's funny. You're still the one I want on Spreaker.com. You're still the one that I love. The only one I dream of." So Joe, shut up. I never pay attention to my chat room. I'm too busy doing a show. I'm buzzing around and getting clips here and talking about this over there and this over here. So, you know what I'm saying? I don't pay attention to the chat room. I look at it. If you hear me get quiet, if somebody's talking on my show, you can be sure I'm over there sneaking up on the chat room. Yeah, so there you go. Boy, Chicago was a great band. They did everything great. Everything they did was great. You know what I mean? They were just unbelievable. How many of you have heard this death audio from this bear attack? I did serious research on this today, and it's true. It is a guy that, did a long study. They called him the Grizzly Man. They did a movie about him. And what happened is his girlfriend's name was Amy, and she was killed too. Amy, something like Hergenard, or it's real hard to say her last name. His name was Timothy Treadwell. And it happened a long time ago. It happened like in 03, but he was camping in a tent, and he was watching bears. Well, he had gone out of the tent to do something, and she had turned on the recorder. It was one of these great big video recorders that had the VHS tape in it, but she hadn't taken the lens cap off yet. And she had hit record, and then when she saw what was going on, she puts it down on the ground, and it continues recording, and it records the audio, and all you can hear is the audio. So it's real, and it's sad. And here it is. Okay, there's one time from the transcript that I read, he says, "Runaway Amy. Amy, run away." And then there's the times that you can hear him say, "Get the frying pan." And she starts hitting the bear with a frying pan, and the bear turns around and gets her. It's really sad. Now that's Amy in the background screaming, "Fight back, fight back." And he's saying, "Amy, get out of here." The bear's already got him in a bear hug, I guess you could say. And he's screaming for her to get out of here, to run away. And you hear her in the background saying, "Fight back, fight back." Now, here's my problem with this situation. Why would they be in the wild without a weapon, without a gun, if just a tranquilizing gun? And if so, why wouldn't she get it and shoot the bear that's killing her boyfriend? I don't understand. I can't imagine that somebody would be in the wild against a creature such as a grizzly bear and not be armed. That would be insane. I'm not saying they got what they deserved, but, you know, this is kind of silly. I mean, they would be in the wild, and why wouldn't she be trained on how to use the weapon? I would have had a sawed-off shotgun or something that would kill a bear and then just bang, kill the bear. I mean, I know people get freaked out about killing animals, but my God, if it got between me and an animal, the animal's going to die, okay? And you know I'm an animal activist. You see what I'm saying? I mean, I'm like, I can't imagine that somebody would be doing this without protection. I mean, I just think that's just bizarre. And then this is a video of the medical examiner, excuse me, that actually did the the autopsies on whatever was left. First, they show Mr. Treadwell out there with the bears.
Timothy Treadwell and A.B. Huguenot's remains came in this large metal can. Inside this metal can was a plastic bag, one for Timothy and one for Amy. I mean, these are human beings, and the question I ask is, first of all, who are you, Timothy? Who are you, Amy? And what happened to you? In the case of Timothy and Amy, what I had were body parts. Just the visual input of seeing a detached human being before my eyes makes my heart race, makes the hair stand up on the back of my head, particularly in combination with the contents of a tape, an audio tape, that is the sound portion of a videotape. And when I find out from other investigators that the shoes neatly placed at the entrance to a tent and the cap left on a camera so that the visual part could not be recorded, yet the tape is running so that we can hear the sounds of Amy screaming and the sounds of Timothy moaning, tells me that this event occurred very, very quickly, suddenly and unexpectedly. I clearly can hear her screaming, stop and go away. Maybe run away. There's a lot of background noise. Timothy is moaning, and I hear Amy beating on the top of this bear's head with a frying pan, and Timothy is saying, run away, let go. Run away, Amy, run away. Amy had a great deal of conviction. She had a great deal of conviction in this relationship, we know that. Although in the past, she was more standoffish. She didn't get as close to the bear as Timothy did. She was more cautious. However, I know that at the moment of death, when one is being tried to the maximum of one's ability to be faithful, to stick to a situation, to be loyal, if one can say that, to Timothy, she stayed there and she fought with Timothy. She did not run away. Amy, we know, fought back for approximately 6 minutes. Amy stayed with her lover, with her partner, with her mate, and with the bear. Ultimately, she stayed with the bear in the situation.
And that's all I have to say about that. And then the ending of the movie is kind of sweet that they did. Here's the ending of the movie on called Grizzly Man.
Well, the expedition coming close to a close, but I'm still, of course, here. It's been over 4 months in the wilderness, and a hurricane force storm now building, over 50-mile-an-hour winds, soon over 70. The bears safely heading for their dens, the work successful. I'm over 20 pounds lighter, my clothes are rags. I've tried hard. I bleed for them, I live for them, I die for them. I love them, I love this. Tough work, but it's the only work I know, and it's the only work I'll ever want. Take care of these animals. Take care of this land.
He seems to hesitate in leaving the last frame of his own film.
It's the only thing I know. It's the only thing I want to know.
Treadwell is gone. The argument how wrong or how right he was disappears into a distance, into a fog. What remains is his footage. And while we watch the animals in their joys of being, in their grace and ferociousness, a thought becomes more and more clear that it is not so much a look at wild nature as it is an insight into ourselves, our nature. And that, for me, beyond his mission, gives meaning to his life and to his death.
They go, ooh, yip, ooh, yip, ooh. Now the longhorns are gone, and the drovers are gone. The Comanches are gone, and the outlaws are gone. Geronimo's
gone,
and Sambas
is gone,
and the lion is gone, and the red wolf is gone,
and Treadwell is gone.
You know, I mean, how do I feel about something like this? I think it was just like I would say to my little brother, it was stupid. Nature is to be respected. I mean, that's a grizzly bear. You are lunch to him. And although I think maybe he was trying to be a little bit like that lion guy, you know, that plays with those lions and stuff, I still think that I would say to him, if I were to run into him in the afterlife, you know, that was not an honorable death. I mean, it was stupid. I mean, again, I mean, on the part of his girlfriend, I think that they should have been armed. If they trusted nature that much, they were foolish. And although I'm not saying that death is something that can be, you know, laughed at, I think it's sad. Of course I think it's sad. I think it's very sad. But still, that doesn't take away from the fact that it was stupid. And if you're honest, you'll say the same thing. And if you're not, you'll disagree. You'll say, oh, Debbie's being mean because she's so mean. Debbie's mean. No, Debbie's honest. I mean, if I was going to go in the wild with Steve Rush to take photographs of grizzly bears, I would say, wait a minute, don't we need a weapon or a gun or a dart gun or something? What if something happens? What if something comes up and attacks? And I'm sure he would agree. And if that would have been Steve, I would have got the gun out and shot the bear dead right in his head or whatever. And although people say, you killed the bear, I would say, well, what would you want me to do, sit and watch it eat Steve? No, of course not. You would want me to kill the bear. And I just keep thinking that. I don't know why. And I just want to slap them. You know, I mean, I'm sorry. I am sorry. What a mess. What a deal. But you know, what do you do? It was dumb. It was dumb. I'm sorry. It was stupid. It was a waste of... This one says it's longer, original.
Ah!
A little more morbid. A little bit more death rattles from the man, I guess. But I'm not sorry. I just think it's... I have very mixed emotions about it. You know what I mean? I have mixed emotions. Because the autopsy pictures, I mean, he obviously ate him for food. Because he would, all of the flesh was torn off the man's legs where he was just chomping and eating it. The bear was having lunch. I don't understand people that do these kind of things. I mean, I really don't. You're just playing with fire. You're playing with death. And I think it's stupid. You know what I mean? I mean, it's sad, but what are you going to do? I mean, you played with fire. You don't play with nature like that. Are you kidding me? There was another man that I noticed was killed by a grizzly bear when he jumps into the bear's thing at the zoo to try to be stupid, you know? I mean, I don't understand why somebody would do this. And he just gets ripped to shreds. And it's all on video. And I'm thinking, why would you do something so stupid? I don't get it.
We see them all the time, but they usually go the other direction. With a sow and cubs, it's a whole different category. And when she saw me, she just basically said, "You're next." I was irrigating my ranch, and I have been doing this at that particular time for 50 years. Every morning I get up early and take off with my shovel, my dog, and I normally carry bear spray when I go hiking out in the hills, which I do a lot, but I was irrigating. Well, June 20th, 2013, as I was doing that, I heard my dog in a terrible fight, just literally screaming. And without thinking, I rushed around the corner. 25 yards away was a sow with two little cubs. Within 2.5 seconds, she was on me. I swung at her with a shovel and hit her, but it didn't dissuade her, and she reached up and basically removed the center of my face. And then we went down on the ground, and she grabbed my left knee and drug me about 20 feet. She just worked me over for, it seemed like long enough, but it was probably like 20 or 30 seconds. And then she took off. I was trying to get my cell phone to work, and as I was doing that, I could hear her coming back, because she had inadvertently charged off the wrong way and left her cubs back behind me. So she came tearing down the hill again. I could hear her huffing and puffing, and she tied into me again, but I was really prepared that time, and that time she just kind of bit my scalp and tried to claw through my back, and then and she left. I laid there for a few more seconds, and then I decided to better change locations, so I got up and walked home. We met the ambulance, and then that was it. I didn't remember anything else till I woke up in Denver. I was in Denver in intensive care for 2 weeks. Well, I was really disappointed that I had set this up, you know, because it was totally on me. I should have read the signs. I should have, you know, instead of just rushing into it. Really wasn't the bear's fault. She wasn't doing anything but what any good mother would do, so. It's in grizzly habitat. There's no question about it, and I've known that for years. It's like blizzards and weeds. Now predators are a fact that's not going to go away. You got to take it more seriously.
And there you go. Proof positive. Just what that guy said. You got to take it serious. You don't mess around with nature. I don't know if any of you guys have heard about this, but I don't know. It's weird to me. It's real weird to me that this guy would do this. I'm looking up bear things. Not looking them up, but I'm just seeing them. This one says, Michigan girl, 12 years old, survived a bear attack. Let's see what this is.
Turn now to an incredible survival story. A 12-year-old girl attacked by a black bear, not once, but twice, and she manages to get away. This morning, she describes those horrifying moments, and ABC's Lindsay Janis is here now with her story. Good morning, Lindsay. So glad she's okay.
She is such a brave little girl. Abigail Weatherall was mauled by a bear near her house in Cadillac, Michigan. Now, after 3 nights in the hospital, she is home with her family and talking about her ordeal exclusively to Good Morning America.
I was terrified.
Abby Weatherall says not only did she come face to face with a black bear like this one, she thought it would be the last face she'd ever see.
I was thinking, oh my gosh, this is it. I'm not gonna live.
The 12-year-old was jogging along this trail Thursday night when she ran across the several hundred pound animal.
All of a sudden the bear got me, put me down on the ground and started like scraping me and clawing me.
She says she scrambled to her feet and ran for her life, but the bear came back.
So I was like petting it. I don't know where that came from, but I just thought maybe if I petted it, it would like me. Well, that did not work. So then it just got me again, and then I heard that you should play dead. So that's what I did. And then it kind of went away, and then it looked back, then it just took off. I got up and I started running to my house.
I think I was in shock when I first saw her.
I was screaming, help, help, and crying.
I didn't believe it was a bear attack until I seen the claw marks and the bruises.
Weatherall suffered deep gashes to her thigh and back and cuts on her face, requiring more than 100 stitches.
You know, it was horrible.
When the bear was attacking me, I couldn't feel it. I was just numb.
This morning, she's not only relishing her big homecoming, she says she's ready to move on.
It's over, but I'm not going to go in the woods without anybody, but I'm still going in the woods. I'm okay, and I'll be all right.
Abby says in the moments after she was attacked, she worried about her school's soccer team, wondering how they were going to win if she wasn't able to play goalie because the other goalie, she explained, had sprained her wrist. And that speaks volumes about who this little girl is.
Unbelievable. Wow.
Incredible. And the presence of mind to remember that she should play dead.
Right.
Incredible.
Playing dead doesn't always work. A lot of times they're there to have you for lunch. So I don't think that playing dead works. I don't think that would work. They say pepper spray drives them crazy and gets rid of them. Of course, I don't have to worry about these. I mean, I'm not around any brown bears. Are you kidding me? But here's the stupidity of that. Okay? You know you've got bears in the forest. So what do? Let's go jogging. Let's go jogging alone. And the stupid little girl says, I'm going to go out in the woods again. So, do you see what I'm saying? It's like, if you hear of this little girl getting mauled to death, who's going to feel sorry for that? I mean, of course it's sad that a little girl dies. Of course it is. But it's almost like you're asking for it. Oh, I'm just going to go out in the woods again. What is that? A grizzly bear is like one of the worst things. That's like a nightmare. Whatever. Here's another one. Alaska bear attack. I'm extremely lucky.
New details now on those tense moments when a grizzly bear attacked a group of teens hiking in Alaska. One of the injured teenagers says it was the scariest moment of his life, and he thought he would not survive. He talked to ABC's Abby Boudreau, and she joins us now live from Anchorage with the latest. Good morning, Abby.
Good morning, Robin. This 17-year-old has an incredible story of survival. He says the last thing he remembers is a giant grizzly bear chasing after him and tackling him. And now he says he's just happy to be alive.
Holy
17-year-old Sam got Sagan and his friends were on a 30-day hike testing their survival skills in Alaska's vast and rugged landscape.
I'd heard it was, you know, a bit more wild and a bit more intense, so I jumped on the opportunity.
Spotting wildlife along the way, like this black bear. But their adventure was about to take a frightening turn.
We hiked about 4 miles, and we were hiking in a stream. The person in front started screaming and yelling, "Bear." And so we all turned around and ran the opposite direction. The most vivid thing, I remember running and looking behind me and just seeing this huge, like, snarling grizzly bear, like, 5 feet behind me.
The bear attacked 4 of the 7 teenagers in his group, including Victor Martin, who says the grizzly was enormous.
Easy, 8 to 9 feet, about 900 pounds.
He fought it off, kicking with everything he had.
Right in the middle, square, right in the middle of the face.
I saw it was all cut up, and I had this big old, you know, chest wound, and I was trying to hold my my ribs because I could see blood coming out when I was breathing, you know, and I could hear it, like, sputtering. They took one of the garbage bags and ripped off a chunk and wrapped it around where my lung was to try and put something plastic over it so it would stop, you know, create, like, an airtight seal.
What was going through your mind at that very moment?
I'm gonna die. Like, I'm too young, I'm about to go to college, I have a family, I have friends at home. Like, I can't believe I'm about to die.
Then, after more than 8 hours of waiting, a rescue helicopter finally arrived.
I think if he'd been a little deeper into my brain, in my head, or into my lung, or into my neck, or anything, I wouldn't, you know, wouldn't have made it. I'm extremely lucky. I'm so lucky.
Lucky but stupid. Here's another one. Witness hunter that witnesses a grizzly bear attack speaks out.
Well, we are hearing more this morning about that grizzly mauling that killed a man last week near the Idaho-Montana state line.
A grizzly attacked and killed 38-year-old Steve Stevenson on Buckhorn Mountain Friday morning. KXY4's Eric Loney has more from one of the hunters who witnessed it all, Eric.
Yeah, that hunter was named Bill Bell. He and his son Ty were hunting black bear Friday with Steve Stevenson and another friend. Around 8:30 that morning, Ty shot what he thought was a black bear. When he and Stevenson approached it, 45 minutes later, Bill Bell says the bear lunged at his son. Stevenson yelled to distract the bear, and it worked. But then that grizzly turned and attacked Stevenson. Bell says Ty shot the bear 3 times, ran out of ammunition, had to run back to camp, get another gun, and then returned to kill the bear. But Stevenson was already dead.
For somebody to wade right into a bear that's mauling somebody and walk up and get point blank and try to kill this bear with no thought of his own life. They were trying to save each other.
Bill Bell says he and his son are experienced hunters and would not have shot at the bear in the first place if they knew it was a grizzly. Bell says they didn't realize it was a grizzly until they pulled it off Stevenson and saw the claws. Reporting live, Eric Loney, KXY4 HD News.
I'm not even going to make a comment on that. I'm just going to leave my mouth shut, you know, because it's going to sound really mean what I have to say. I'm serious. Well, we wouldn't have shot it if we would have known it was a grizzly. What? What does that even mean? Oh, man. I don't know.
Well, some of Yellowstone's trails, campsites, and roads near where this grizzly bear attack took place are closed at this hour. Visitors are being kept out for their own safety. It's a tragic reminder that one of the country's most beautiful landscapes is still very wild. It was here on Yellowstone's Wapiti Lake Trail, about a mile and a half in, where a couple came face to face with a grizzly bear. The wife told officials she and her 57-year-old husband saw a bear with cubs from a distance, but they continued walking. When they saw the bear a second time, it was already charging them, attacking and killing the husband.
Some other hikers on the trail heard the woman's cries for help, and they called 911, which summoned rangers.
Park officials estimate some 150 grizzlies live in Yellowstone, hundreds more in the surrounding area. Still, maulings are rare.
This is the first time that there has been a bear-caused human fatality in Yellowstone in 25 years.
Nearby, however, there have been other bizarre attacks.
911, what is your emergency?
Hi, I'm in Cook City right now, and we had someone that's been attacked and bitten pretty badly by a bear.
Just outside Yellowstone last year, a 48-year-old man was mauled to death while sleeping in a tent.
There was probably a lot of panic and moving around, and I think that would motivate that prey instinct these animals do have.
Now, as for this latest grizzly bear attack, park officials say they will not try to capture or kill that mother grizzly bear. They believe she was simply trying to defend her cubs. That is a natural behavior, but unfortunately one that sometimes turns deadly.
Who would even consider killing the bear?
Well, let's go kill the bear.
Are you kidding me? What sort of an idiot would do something like that? What sort of an idiot would do something like that? Well, time to go kill the bear. That's stupidity. That's ignorant. That is idiots. I don't get it. Here's how to survive a bear attack.
The kickoff of GMA Survival Week, and try to imagine coming face to face with a grizzly bear, terrifying and potentially deadly, but there are some things you can do to increase your chances of survival in an encounter, and ABC's Matt Gutman is here with more on this. Matt, do tell.
That's right, Lara. In order to do that, we had to spend a day with a 1,300-pound grizzly. I even felt its hot breath on my face. But with the increase in human-bear interactions in recent years, the best survival tip, of course, is to avoid them. But as one pair of hunters learned, if you're attacked, fight with everything you've got.
You could feel it puncture deeply. And you could feel the teeth.
Michael Snowden and his son-in-law, Jeff Ostrin, lucky to be alive this morning after an unbelievable clash with two brown bears.
I could see him just shaking his...
Here's how you survive a bear attack. You don't go around bears. You don't go in bear territory. I mean, that's stupid. And if you go into bear territory thinking you're going to kill a grizzly bear, good luck. I'm sorry, I just think it's stupid. I think it's dumb, and I don't know. I've just got my own opinions about stuff. I just think it's stupid. Here's one that, let's see, brutal bear attack in Florida? That wouldn't be a grizzly. A grizzly bear is enormous. They weigh up to 900 pounds. And no, I'm not going to wrestle the grizzly bear. I'm not going to go in. I'm not going to put myself in that situation. That's called being intelligent. I mean, I wouldn't even go out of the car in Yellowstone National Park if I knew that there were grizzly bears there. Because that's called stupid. Ignorant. Not ignorant, stupid. Ignorance when you don't know any better. Stupid is when you know better and you still act like an idiot. Here's somebody named Mark survived with a pepper spray.
Bear is just storming right at you like a locomotive and just... And here she comes and all you want to do is get out of its way. We're up bow hunting at the time, and we're coming down a trail through the timber to the left. I caught a quick movement. As I spun around, it was only 15 feet and just right there. And I remember just looking and seeing what a beautiful animal. It was silver-tipped. It was healthy. It didn't have a collar on it. It was just natural grizzly bear in the wild. And here she comes, just grunting like that, just this. That first lunge can be at 30 feet and reach a burst of 30 miles an hour. And that's what's so overwhelming. You just don't have much time to react. I thought, this is not happening. And so I glanced for a tree to jump into. Nothing was climbable. I knew I didn't have much time. This bear was only 35 yards and coming quick through the timber. She lunged over that log and bit me right through the chest, and I spun and she then ripped into my face. I thought, this is it. I mean, you know, my time on earth here is finished. I yelled at my partner, Fred. I said, she's got my head. She's killing me. Then she just really clamped down hard. And I knew that the only thing I could do was just play dead. That's the only thing you can do, or else they're going to... I just felt like I was going to be dead.
An effective and non-lethal alternative for stopping a charging bear is pepper spray. easier to use and less cumbersome than a firearm. When used within a 35-foot radius, pepper spray has proven effective in warding off an attack.
He distracted it by yelling at it. He came in with his little can of pepper and yelled at the bear, and as soon as the bear then turned towards them, he sprayed it in the mouth.
Every survival situation is particular. There is no one rule to follow in a bear encounter. Being prepared is the best way to offset the shock and speed of an episode.
Being prepared, like I said, is the only way to offset an episode. That's very true. Be prepared. Be prepared. Be prepared. Shut up. Be prepared. Be prepared. Always remember this little song. Be prepared. Let's listen to Joe Seeker some more. I'm so bored. I'm so bored.
That was the only thing more painful than listening to Debbie Daly breaking my heart. When he was trying to insert his fucking penal fucking understanding of the world, you know, the minimal amount of understanding anyone could possibly have of world affairs, when he was trying to insert that on every topic, like he was an expert, and only come out sounding like an asshole, like, what was the one? Oh, but they were talking about the minimum wage being $18 in Australia, and it's actually a form of corruption. It's a form of corruption, he said, because, you know, the people are corrupt. Well, how? Because they are, and he kept trying to find a way to explain it. And he even said one time that the majority of the people of Australia are forcing tyranny on the minority of Australians, which would be the business owners, because they get $18 an hour minimum wage. Not that I want to rain on Mr. Midnight Movies Parade, because he seems like he's a, you know, like an awesome guy at parties. Not sure if he knows, but it is law in Australia that you vote. If you don't vote in Australia, you pay a big fine on your income tax. So their voter turnout is extremely high compared to other Western nations. Extremely high. I want to add another fact. A few more. Australia is the only Western country that does not owe any money to the World Bank. Yeah. Go figure, eh? Their dollar is at par, roughly, with the United States. For that very reason. Right. So, before I went flipping me gums off about Australia, I would read up on it a bit there, Mr. Midnight Movie. Because you seem very ill-informed. And I'm going to try to make you understand it. I know you won't, because you're clouding your head with conservative logic, but try to think of it like this. If the government is going to give somebody a tax break, because let's face it, that's where all money comes from, in the sense that we're talking about it, right? Like, if the government is going to give a break, and we're going to use McDonald's, say, for the example, okay? They have $1 million to give away, right? so they can decide, we're going to, you know, give a 1% tax break to high money earners, which would be the owners of McDonald's, the corporation, the guy that owns that franchise. And then he can trickle that down. So we're going to give, you know, it's going to work out. It's going to be $1 million in a tax break for McDonald's in, say, I don't know, Perth, Australia. It's the way it's going to work out. Now, the corporation, they don't trickle that shit down. They divvy that up amongst shareholders. So if you want any trickle down from that, you got to be a shareholder. Right? Which is fine. But how many shareholders are going to get a piece of that? You know what I mean? And then how many of those shareholders, you know, are spending money within the community? Okay? Or you could take the same $1 million, right? Give the tax break rather to the corporation or the owner. You can give the tax break to the employees, be it through a higher wage or, you know, an income tax break. And then you can give $1,000 to 1,000 employees. The government's not owed anything. Because it's either $1 million tax break to the rich or $1 million tax break to the employees. Now, what's going to be better for the economy? Huh? $1 million in some asshole's fucking bank account that don't spend his money anyway? Or 1,000 people with $1,000 who live directly in your community, who shop at the small businesses you claim to defend, who buy gas, who buy TVs, buy shoes. Like, it's just common sense. It's just the manufacturing sector or the retail sector itself would benefit from having to sell 999 more pairs of shoes. Or fucking whatever. So it's basic fucking common sense when you look at the numbers. Now, if you want to spend your time listening to Fox News and come up with such detailed intricate fucking taxation schemes, then I understand why you don't understand the world, because Fox News is paid to present the agenda of a certain percentage of the population. But you can't ignore the economic fucking reality of anything. And if that's not enough for you, I want you to think of what it was like when you were a kid. Okay? And everything is relative to playing with your building blocks, Mr. Midnight Movie. If you try to put all the weight up on top, if you build like a tower or you build a pyramid, doesn't matter what you build with your blocks, if you try to put the biggest piece on the top without first making a good strong foundation, it'll just collapse amongst itself because it can't sustain it. Nothing can be top heavy. Nothing. It has to be strong from the bottom up. Or it's fucking doomed to fail. But now that we're all done talking about that, I want to go back to my broken heart. My broken, broken heart. Oh, we got somebody in the chat. Oh, it's Informant News. My bathtub girl's always here to pick me up after Debbie rejects me. She told me. She said, "Don't fly too close to the sun with your spreaker wings, Angry Bong. For the heat of Debbie. If you fly too close to Debbie, she'll melt the wax in your wings and you'll fall into the sea." Yeah, that's what happened to me. That's what happened to me. I flew too close to the sun, flew too close to the Debbie, and she melted the wax in my wings. Here's a special request for me to Debbie. Special request from me to Debbie.
This goes back to Joe Seeger. New Orleans. I always say things weird. People get a rise out of hearing me say the word P-O-E-M. How do you pronounce P-O-E-M? I say poem. Poem. People say poem or something like palm or something like that. I'm looking to see if my show stay up on the live now list. We're still having fun. Yeah, we're up there. We're above Pumpkin Face and the Truth Porn Militia. We're above The Right Perspective. Who else is on right now? I can't see anybody else on. Oh, we're way above DJ Bad Guy. He's way down at the bottom. I told him on my show, I'm not on my show page, he left all these shitty comments. He called Goose and Balls baby killers. And I said, you know, guy, I think you're jealous. I think you're a jealous little girl. Except you're a jealous old woman. He goes, well, then ban me, cunt. And I said, you know, you really think that word bothers me? How much you want to bet he's talking about me? Let's go take a listen. I hear nothing.
Motorcade when they opened the Monterey Aquarium. And I'm thinking, you know, of course I was volunteered.
That's really funny because, like, you're. Because when I say 96 anything, people are like, what? Because most of them came in after I did. And so those numbers.
And now he's going to be kissing Goose's ass. Clearly after what he said about Goose on my show. You know what I mean? He's such a kiss ass. It's just ridiculous. So I told him to get screwed and stay away from me. Go away. Get away from me, guy. He's just, yuck. A Goose is making the rounds. He comes on my show. He comes on your show. He comes on everybody's show. I know, it's stupid. A guy in Reno, Nevada got 28 years for torturing dogs. They found him in a hotel room with 8 dog heads in various parts. Oh, that's nice. What do I think of the tragedy in Oregon? I don't know. You don't want to know my opinion. You don't want to know my opinion of that. I don't know. I don't know. I'm going to keep my mouth shut about that. hey, I can end it by doing 1 hour exactly. I've never done this before. I'll end it and say I did 1 hour. I've never done that before. Did I just repeat myself? I think I did. I went to the chat room and there's nothing going on over there. Just Stabby's usual bullshit. So, I've lost all my music on my thing here. I've lost all of it. I can't find any of it anymore. I can't. I don't know where it went. Where is it all? I uploaded all this music and now I don't see it on here anymore. Looking Glass, Dancing in the Moonlight, Gordon Lightfoot, Arlo Guthrie, Billy Idol, Phil Collins, Three Dog Night, Billy Idol, Tony Orlando, ZZ Top, AC/DC, CeeLo Green, Mariah Carey. There it is. I found it. So from the album of the same name from 1988, we have Mr. White in the chat room singing I'm Worried About My Heart. And I'll see you guys the next time I do this.
This morning, it's really not that bad. I got ways of getting through this. I start talking to my cat.